हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज 11th सेशन ऑफ क्वांटिटी सर्विंग एंड कॉन्ट्रैक्ट मैनेजमेंट मॉड्यूल 5। थिंग्स वी लर्न इन लास्ट सेशन आर एडिशंस एंड अल्टरेशंस और वेरिएशंस एंड डिविएशंस। Valuation of variation, breach of contract, penalty on contractor, and blacklisting of contractor. These are all the things we learned in last session. I hope everyone are following. Now we'll see what is termination of contract. The contract agreement may be terminated in the following conditions. First one, bankruptcy. Second one, breach of conditions. Third one, impossibility to complete work. Fourth one, agreement. Fifth one, completion of work. Any of the contract will be terminated based on these following five conditions. If there is any kind of bankruptcy, then because of the shortage of fund, a person can't complete the contract, so the contract will be terminated. Or breach in the condition. If there is, we already studied what is breach of condition or breach of contract. So if there is any breach, then it will be terminated. Impossibility to complete work. There will be some sort of work, or we will encounter some conditions where it will be like that we can't even complete the work. In those conditions, the contract will be terminated. And agreement. Mutual agreement between the client and the contractor. If they both agree for the termination, then the contract will be terminated. Then after the completion of work also, to end the contract, they will refer it as termination of the contract. First one, bankruptcy. If both or one of the parties become bankrupt, the contract may be terminated since the work cannot be completed due to lack of fund. As I already said, if any of the party, like some bankrupt problem has happened, work will be terminated because lack of fund. Next, breach of condition. If one party fails to follow the conditions mentioned in the contract, then the other party has every right to terminate the contract and also claim for damages done to him through court of law or through arbitration. This is nothing but we already studied what is breach of contract. If there is any breach, breach is nothing but one party or the other party, like it may be the contractor or it may be the owner, if they fail to follow any one of the rule of contract, then it is like the breach. If that happened, then also the final process will be the termination. Impossibility to complete work. Due to valid reasons, it may not be possible to complete the job which is partially completed. For example, the land may be acquired by the government or floods may drown the land, etc. In all such cases, the contract is terminated as it is impossible to complete the work. The damages to the contractor shall be made good by the owner or the department, as the case may be. Impossibility. If, like, on the process of work, maybe there will be some situations like the government acquiring the land or some flood issue, that time the work will be partially done, but it is impossible to complete the work. So we have to terminate that work. And the damages that had caused to the contractor will be helped by the owner or the department who are like in charge. Fourth one, agreement. Due to extraordinary circumstances, it may become necessary to terminate the contract by mutual agreement. For example, the owner or contractor may expire, or no other person may be there to fulfill the agreement. It is like because of some extraordinary circumstances. Like, we can't predict this, okay, this situation will come. Like, on those situations and all, by mutually agreeing between the client and the contractor, the contract will be terminated. For example, we can say it may be like the owner or the contractor, if any one of the person expires, then the contract can't move on. So that time, the person who is in charge of the owner or the contractor, that person and the other person will mutually agree and they will terminate the contract. Fifth one, completion of the work. If the work is completed satisfactorily as per the conditions in the agreement, then also the contract is terminated. After making the final payment to the contractor and releasing his security deposit, after the completion of the work satisfactorily as per contract document and the agreement, then it is called as termination. After terminating, here the final payment for the contractor is made, and the client who is holding on the security deposit, that security deposit is also released. To terminate a contract, a registered notice is served on contractor framing charges against him for violation of a clause of the terms and conditions of contract, allowing a fixed time of usually 7 days or 14 days. In case the contractor fails to defend him or the notice remains unreplied, then the contract can be terminated by the owner. That is, if there is any mistake from the side of contractor, if he didn't obey any of the rules or regulations about the contract document, then the owner will send a format or the violation letter against the contractor. That will be sent to the contractor also. If the contractor didn't reply for the letter within the 7 to 14 days, then the owner will be having complete rights to terminate the contract. Settlement of account or final payment. Now we'll see what is settlement of account or final payment. Settlement of account or the final payment. As the name suggests, it is the final payment. After the works are completed in all respect, the engineer accurately prepares the final amount of the work, and then after deducting all previous payments, the owner pays the final amount to the contractor. That is, after all the work has completed, the engineer will estimate or we will calculate the final amount. That final amount he will give to the client. Then the client will deduct all the previous payments that he has made to the contractor. Then he will pay the final amount to the contractor. The usual provision to be made under this clause will be as follows. First one, the period to be given to the engineer for preparation of the final bill is usually a fortnight to 1 month. Fortnight is nothing but 14 days period. That is, an engineer has to prepare the final bill in the time period of 14 days to 1 month. Second one, the period to be given to the owner for paying the final amount is usually a fortnight to 1 month. The owner has to pay all the final amount to the contractor. He can only take the time for 14 days or 1 month. There is mention of certain percentage of amount during maintenance period, if any. During the maintenance period, the contractor can take the amount for those things also. A typical clause can be framed as follows. After acceptance of the work under this contract, the engineer shall prepare a final estimate of the works as soon as practicable, but within 1 month from the date of such acceptance, and the engineer shall give a certificate of final payment to the contractor. The owner, after receipt of such certificate from the contractor, shall pay the entire sum within 1 month after deducting all previous payments, other dues, etc. 1/2 of the retained amount shall be paid along with the final payment, while the other half shall be paid at the end of the maintenance period. Initially, the engineer, after the completion of the work from the contractor, the engineer will go and he will estimate, he will give the final estimate with a letter of acceptance. Then the owner, checking both the things, he should pay the money to the contractor within 1 month. But the half of the money will be paid now and other half of the money will be paid after the end of the maintenance period. Next we'll see what is delays and compensation. Delays in the construction projects can be defined as the time difference between the date of project completion stated in the contract and date of actual completion. The delay in construction project is that the difference between the time limit of the completion date stated in the contract document to the actual completion date. That difference is nothing but delay in construction project. A fundamental specification of a construction contract is the project period or time of project execution, which is established prior to bidding. A time period of the project is like a fundamental specification of construction contract. This time period will be established prior to the bidding. Like before the bidding, the time period of the project will be stated. The successful execution of construction projects and keeping them within estimated cost and prescribed schedules depend upon a methodology that requires expert engineering judgment. Project completion for owner means that he can make use of his new asset on time by habitation, renting or selling. Maintaining the schedule and estimated cost of any of the project within the prescribed limit, it requires an expert judgment. That is, here the contractor should have more knowledge of managing things. Whereas for the owner, the project completion means it's like new except asset time for him. Like he can use it or he can sell it or he can rent it. Any delay in project completion will disturb his plans. The owner will be having so many plans after the construction of any of his asset. If there is any delay, his plans will be disturbed. The client will not be able to make use of the property and his business will be affected in almost all areas, especially finance. Because of the delay, client cannot be able to use the asset or his property, so it will affect him a lot. In almost all the aspects it will affect him, but especially in the area of finance it will affect him more. For the contractor, any delay in completion of the project gives rise to indirect overhead expenses and additional payments to the project staff and workforce. The delay in the completion of the project not only affects the client but also it will affect the contractor such that it will increase in the indirect cost. And because of additional working days, additional payment for the staff or workforce. It also means that he will possibly be subjected to compensation claims. If the delay is caused by some of the owner issue, then the contractor will be subjected to compensation. His next project might be cancelled as a result of delay in the present project and loss of future opportunities will be made more likely to damage to his reputation and creditability. Because of the delay in the present project will disturb the contractor's future project and it will damage his reputation and creditability also. Construction contracts generally allow the construction period to be extended where there is delay that is not the contractor's fault. This is described by extension of time. We already know the extension of time is nothing but it is a provision given to the contractor because if there is any delay or anything caused by the owner's side. When it becomes reasonably apparent that there is likely to be a delay that could merit an extension of time, the contractor gives written notice to the contractor administrator identifying the relevant event that has caused the delay. If there is any act which has caused the delay in the project, then the contractor has to identify it and he should give a notice to the contractor administrator or contractor in charge engineer. Based on the notice which the contractor has given, the extension of time will be sanctioned. If the contractor administrator accepts that the delay was caused by a relevant event, then they may grant an extension of time and completion date is adjusted. Based on the contractor notice, the contract administrator will completely go through that notice, and if the act or by which the extension has been made is relevant, then they will grant the extension of time and they will adjust the completion date of the project. Relevant events that cause the extension of time are: first one, variations. Any variations made by client, exceptional adverse weather, civil commotion or terrorism event, failure to provide information, any of the information which has been failed to provide it by the client, delay on the part of nominated subcontractor, if the work has to be made by the subcontractor has delayed, statutory undertaker work, a delay in giving the contractor possession of site, delay made by the owner to give the site, force majeure like act of God, loss from specified things like flood or any other disaster, the supply of materials and goods by the client. If the client makes delay in supplying any of the materials, strikes, changes in statutory requirements, the contractor is required to prevent or mitigate the delay and any result loss, even where the fault is not their own. The contractor has to try to prevent or reduce this kind of losses. Even if the fault is not on the contractor side, then also he should try to prevent those delays. Assessing claims for an extension of time can be complicated and controversial. Extension of time will be provided if there is any delay, but accessing claim for that is kind of complicated. There may be multiple or concurrent delays, some of which are contractor fault and not. There may be any of the conditions where so much of delay will be there in the project. It may be contractor fault or may not be contractor fault also. There are many occasions where contractors contribute to delay themselves by their performance during design period. When producing drawing, mock-ups and samples, or in interfacing with subcontractors. There are some cases where the delay will be caused by contractor itself, by his performance or by whatever the drawing he had to provide, if he make delay of that drawing, then the delay will be caused by the contractor itself. Then some of his conflicts between the subcontractor, that will also cause the delay. Crucial in assessing applications for extension of time is the quality of the information provided and records available. To get the access to extension of time, the records should be maintained properly. Whatever the thing had happened, for that delay has caused, then for that, if you are claiming for extension of time, then the act for which the delay has caused, for that records has to be kept. The contract administrator may review extension of time after practical completion and further adjust a completion date. The contract administrator will review all these documents and he will provide the extension of time and he will further adjust the completion date. If a delay occurred which was not contractor's fault, then the contractor would no longer be required to complete the work by completion date and would only then have to complete the work in reasonable time. The client would lose any rights to liquidated damages. We already studied what is liquidated damages. If any of the delay occurred because of client issue, then the contractor will definitely get the extra time. But the client will lose his rights on liquidated damages. Claims for extension of time can run alongside claims for loss and expenses. However, one need not necessarily lead to other. The extension of time and the claim will run together. But it is not like one will cause the other. They just run together. Only that. If event occur during the course of work that causes the completion of the work to be delayed, then this may be compensation event. If any of the event which occurs during the course of work and because of that event, if the work is delayed, then that event is called as compensation event. Compensation event will normally result in additional payment being made to the contractor and may result in adjustment of the completion dates or key dates. The contract limits compensation. This compensation event will always lead to the additional payment, where the contractor have to adjust the completion dates and key dates. The contract limit compensation events to those identified in the contract. If the event is not mentioned, then no claim. This compensation is given only when the compensation event is mentioned or identified in the contract. If that event is not mentioned, then there will not be any claim. Specific identified compensation events include instruction to change the service, like variations, failure to provide access. Failure of the client to provide equipment, plant and machinery. Mistake done by the client. An instruction to halt or delay the work. Work done by others. Conditions that could not reasonably have foreseen, like act of God or any strikes, terrorism. These are the acts which are not, cannot be foreseen. These all things will be mentioned in the contract document. These are identified compensation events. Exceptionally adverse weather, like weather disaster. Force majeure, it's like act of God. The contract also makes provision for early warning procedure. If the contractor or the client has any kind of early signs of delay, then they has to provide a warning for that. Both parties must give early warning of anything that may delay the work or increase the cost. As I said, both the parties, if they get any signs of delay, then they must give the warning. They should then hold an early warning meeting to discuss how to avoid or mitigate impacts on the project. After giving the warning, the contractor and the client should have a meeting. It is called early warning meeting to discuss how they can avoid or how they can control the impact of that event on the project. If the contractor fails to give early warning of a possible delay to the work or increase in the cost, they will only be compensated for effects that would have remained. If they fail to provide the warning, or if the contractor failed to provide the early warning, then the compensation will be made only on the remaining thing, like remaining part of the work. Things we learn in this session are: termination of contract, settlement of account or final account, and delays and compensation. Assignment question. Thank you. Stay home. Stay safe.